begin our worship. And this is a true worship service. I know one of the desires that Jackie had, as well as the rest of the family, was that we would be gathered in the Lord's house. And that house was hopefully to be at our Luther Banner site in the sanctuary, but that was not available to us. The worship site at Berea Lutheran Church, the same thing. And so our desire was to try to create a worship space. I know where two or three are gathered together in His name. He said He is there, and we can worship Him anywhere. But Jackie spent her life in the house of God, at the altar of God, a life that started in at the baptismal font, a life that brought her week after week after week to the Lord's table, surrounding His altar. And so we believed it was important for this day for us to be reminded one more time of the amazing gift that has been given to Jackie through the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so that is why we have tried to create the church here. Liturgical banners that were part of the worship space that she would frequent, the same altar cross, the same candles, all of these things were put in place here for that. So let us together as a family of faith begin with our opening hymn, On Eagle's Wings. Gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
In holy baptism, Jacqueline Kohlmeyer was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all her sin. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?"
We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For with him and united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his.
And we will read responsively Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters.
He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Even though I walk in the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for your loving kindness shown to Jacqueline and to all your servants, who, having finished their course in faith, now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful unto death and receive the crown of eternal life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Savior Jesus Christ has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Let us remember with thanksgiving what God has done through his servant Jackie. Jacqueline A. Kohlmeyer was born December 3, 1936 in Tilden, Nebraska, to parents Norman and Opal Hansen. She was reborn as a child of God in the waters of holy baptism on January 10, 1937 at Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Tilden, Nebraska. She confirmed her Christian faith on May 29, 1949 and was fed the life-giving body and blood of her Savior Jesus. She was united in holy marriage to William Kohlmeyer on July 21, 1958, and blessed with 54 years of marriage prior to bills preceding her in death on July 19, 2012. God also blessed them with the gift of children, Daniel and his wife Sarah, David and his wife Joanne, James and his wife Laura. They were also blessed with grandchildren, Elizabeth and her husband Reverend Jeffrey Dock, Jonathan and his wife Anna, Rebecca, Matthew, Michaela, Jacob, Elijah, Luke, and Krista Jacqueline, as well as great-grandchildren Lydia, Peter, Paul, and Martha Dock. Jackie served her Lord and his people faithfully all her years, especially in her vocation as a registered nurse, most notably as a psychiatric nurse. Jackie served her Lord's church in many capacities as a pastor's wife in Cleveland, Ohio, Denver, Colorado, and Milwaukee, Wisconsin. She produced bulletins and newsletters. She taught Sunday school and helped with Vacation Bible School. She served on some of the altar guilds. She even played piano at some of the nursing home services in Cleveland. Until the time of her death, Jackie gathered weekly for regular worship at Berea's main campus and then later at our Luther Manor campus, and was a regular attendee of our Luther Manor Monday Bible study. On March 13, 2020, God called his Jackie home to heaven to await the resurrection of the dead. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Our readings are as follows. The first reading comes from Isaiah chapter 43. He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading, our second reading, comes from John's Revelation, the 21st chapter. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be mine. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our gospel reading comes also from the Apostle John. This is from his gospel, the 10th chapter. Jesus said, truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and he will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming, leaves the sheep and flees. and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, so there will be one flock and one shepherd. Here ends our readings. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ Jesus. Living together in trust and in hope, let us together as a family of faith confess this faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And let us now sing our next hymn, which is found on the insert of your worship folder. Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father, and from from our Lord and our dear Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The only times I've ever had an opportunity to sing that song were the baptisms that your father and grandfather and great-grandfather would do, because he made sure that every one of those baptisms would have that song. And his funeral. And now Jackie's. And it is such a beautiful piece as we come together and we're reminded that we are born in Christ Jesus in those waters of baptism. It is the robe of righteousness that covers all of our sin, a robe of righteousness that we display in a metaphoric form using a pall. We're reminded that at those waters of baptism that he marked us with the sign of the Holy Cross both upon our forehead and upon our heart, and he called us his own. Isaiah 43, that's what we spend time in, isn't it? It is because of those waters of baptism that we one day will stand before him, clothed in white robes and standing before the throne crying out, "Hosanna, Lord, you have saved us. Salvation is yours." Revelation chapter 7. And of course, Revelation chapter 21. And it is because it is through those waters of holy baptism that he has promised to shepherd us. To not be our Almighty God moving us around like pieces on a chessboard. No, he is our shepherd. He goes before us. He walks with us. He walks behind us. He completely surrounds us. All of that happened in the waters of baptism when he says, "I was there to hear your warning." Your dad was a golfer. You guys all know that. Your grandpa, your great-grandpa, he was a golfer. And he loved to golf. I'm not saying he was good. I'm saying that he loved to golf. And I remember when I was started at Sherman Park Lutheran Church, and he was the vacancy pastor there. And so what Sherman Park decided to do is they wanted to retain him as a pastor there to assist me, because I was new in the role of pastor. I was a second career guy. And so your dad would, he agreed to stay on board, but he agreed based on a few rules. And the first rule was that I was going to do everything he didn't want to do. And that he would get to push me around and say or do to me whatever he wanted to do. And he would laugh when he would tell me this. Well, part of what he wanted is that he wanted me to go golfing with him. So I would go golfing with him on Thursday. Now, I'm not a good golfer at all. And I didn't like golf as much as he did. But it was part of the rules in that I had to do whatever he said I was supposed to do. So we would gather together every Thursday morning, 6:30 a.m., down in Oak Creek, because that was the golf course near your mom and dad's house, and we would golf. No golf carts, none of that kind. No. You had to walk. And it didn't matter if it was frost on the ground or if it was 100 degrees outside, you walked. And except with your dad, you kind of ran because he went really fast. And he made this rule. And the rule was this: whoever loses buys lunch. All right. I'm willing to do that. And he would snicker. And of course, the first week, I lost. Because the last time I had golfed was maybe 20 years prior to that. The next week, I got really close to beating him. In fact, I think I beat him on the front nine, but then I lost in the end. And so I bought lunch. And from that moment on, for the next 3.5 years, I never bought another watch. You see, there are two sides to every story. Here's the other side of that story. Bill had a beautiful wife by the name of Jackie. And Bill told Jackie what he was doing to this kid. And all of a sudden, I won every week. Sometimes I knew that there were times when his score was a better score than mine, but all of a sudden he would go, well, we were playing just the front nine today. Or we were playing just the back nine. Or we were playing whoever lost the least amount of balls in the wall. There was a different story every week. But the back end of that story was this. Jackie said to Bill, he will never buy lunch again. But I never knew. Up until that Wednesday that I came over to the house, this final Wednesday, was why. And the reason for that, I mentioned to her, you do know that there's a story I'm going to tell, and she smiled and she says, I know exactly the story that you're going to tell, and that was it. And she said, the reason I did that is because you might not know this, you are my adopted son. So you guys got another brother, by the way. But that was Jackie. That was Jackie for me. And it was this joyful relationship that her and I had. When she was able to come, when she came back to Berea Lutheran Church, why, you know, of course, she was at Sherman Park, and then they went to Risen Savior Lutheran in Franklin, and I didn't lose touch with them, but I lost the opportunity to be able to be her pastor. And then she moved up here to, up towards Lutheran Manor, and then she became a member of Berea, and I remember her saying to me that I want you to be my pastor again. She didn't have to make sure that anybody bought me lunch anymore. But what she did was she was faithful. She was faithful in word and sacrament. She was faithful in gathering around God's word and Bible study. And even during those times when she couldn't make it on her own, something tells me Mom was the one that made sure one of the sons or daughters got her to church. Because that's what Mom did. You gather together here today to remember Mom. And I'm sure it's not exactly the way that you would have planned this. One of the reasons that I wanted to choose for you Revelation 21 is because John did not think things were going to go the way that they were going to go. You see, John had experienced Jesus from the beginning of his ministry. John saw Jesus baptized. John was there when the Heavenly Father said, I was there to hear your mourning cry. And John walked with his Savior Jesus for 3.5 years. He knew Jesus was the Messiah, the promised King of all creation. He knew all of these things. He was the one part of the privileged group that got to witness what Jesus did. It was Peter, James, and John. They were up on the Mount of Transfiguration, and they saw Jesus in his full glory. They were there to see Jesus as he rose Lazarus from the dead. He was one of the ones that was taken in, that came into Gethsemane and watched Jesus on his face in agony, begging his Father for a different way for salvation to go. Some things he understood, most things he didn't. He's the only recorded disciple that was at the cross of his Savior as he watched Jesus hang there naked on a cross, suffering and dying for the sins of the world. And he was there on that Easter Sunday morning, coming to the tomb. Peter got to it first, right, but didn't go inside. Who went inside first? John. And he saw that his Savior was alive. He knew that. And then, over the course of the next period of time, he journeyed with Jesus as Jesus prepared him to now start that church. And John had this message of a Savior, and he was taking it into a world, and it was a world that was not responding to it. Now, certainly, we would look at it a little different. We would say, well, there were 3,000 here that became believers, and there were Pharisees that became believers, and there were churches started all over the place. Yet, there were many that wanted to rub out the way. And John is now exiled to the island of Patmos. And all of those guys that John was with are gone. Jesus left. John saw him go into heaven. That he was there on the ascension. He was part of the privileged. But then one by one, all of his brothers were killed. This isn't how it's supposed to go. John is thinking. The message of salvation is such a beautiful message, and yet why am I hurting so much? And the Lord Jesus comes to him and he gives him a revelation. You see, that's what that whole story is. That last chapter of our Bibles is a culmination of all of God's word rolled into one. But it's something else. You see, it is the other side of the story. John sees Jesus ascended to heaven. He saw it on our level, eye to eye, face to face. And he saw him go. And what Jesus did is Jesus gave him a vision of what that looked like from heaven's perspective. And he got to see Ascension Day from heaven's perspective. That's revelation. He got to see the Lamb of God enter heaven again, and the Father hands him his throne and gives him the seals and gives him the scrolls and all of these. He gets to see the four living creatures and all the elders and all of the angels and archangels and all the company of heaven surrounding Jesus and proclaiming, salvation is yours. You are the king. Behold those that are arrayed in white. Don's going to play that as we finish tonight. Behold the host. And he gives John this encouragement that, John, you've only seen half the story down there. Here's the other half. This is the joyous half. This is the half that will allow you to continue your work down there, knowing that this is what's happening on the other side of those clouds. Well, what does that have to do with all of you this evening? You're John. You've been blessed with a beautiful family, a family that has been nurtured in the love and admonition of the Lord. You have parents that were faithful to you, that made sure that you were brought to the waters of baptism, that you were led through God's word, whether it be in Lutheran schools or in home study or whatever that may be. And now you have grown and you have moved on, and you have done the same thing with each one of your families. And you have a beautiful family that gathers together, a family that loves each other and gets along with each other and celebrates time together with each one. You have successful careers. You have children that are faithful to the word, children that have wonderful opportunities to be able to move on in this world and do some amazing things. You have all of this stuff going on. And then a few years ago, Mom has a few falls. All of a sudden, Mom's health is in some pretty serious jeopardy. And so all the joys that you have now include all the weight of that. What do we do? How do we do the right thing for Mom? How do we do things that are gonna work out with each and every one of us? You begin balancing the joys, and you balance them with the struggles. And then the C word, cancer. You didn't plan on that either, did you? I'm certain Jackie didn't plan on that. And in the midst of all of those things, you by faith stay strong in the Lord. You trust what God's promises are, because you see, you're still on this side of the ascension. You with John saw Jesus go. You're reminded of it every year as you gather together in the Lord's house. You hear the story of the ascension, right? You've seen him go. You trust that he's going to fulfill all of these promises still to come, and yet your hearts are heavy. And then during the final couple of weeks, you begin to see Mom not always in comfort. Sometimes in great distress, and your heart hurts. And you know that what she wants is to be in the presence of her Jesus, and in the presence of her Bill, and in the presence of all those that have gone before her. But for some reason, she's here suffering. And because she suffers, and because you are the family that you are, you suffer too. You see this side of the story. But what I want you to see on this day is that even though this isn't what you expected, the desire would be that all of those people that wanted to come and give their condolences to you and offer you a hug and spend time with you once more telling Jackie stories. You don't get any of that. You're wondering, by the way, when you get here, are you even going to be able to sit together? See, you're John on the island of Patmos. But you only have this side of the story. You see, through that hymn that we sang, I was there to hear your warning cry. I was there when you were young. I put my mark on you, Jesus said. And I will be with you. And I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. And you see, by faith, we believe that. By faith, we try to draw our strength from that. We draw our strength from Isaiah chapter 43, that he will be with us in the midst of our sorrow, in the midst of our, in the midst of the flames and the rushing rivers and the deep waters. By faith, we believe that there will be a time when we will stand face to face and eye to eye with our Jesus. And we trust in that and we lean on that. By faith, the words of that he is the good shepherd are words that, that oftentimes bring us comfort, but not always. But you see, the other side of the story is this. Revelation, gathered around the throne from ascension through eternity, are the four living creatures and the elders and the apostles and the prophets and all those that have gone before you and all the angels and all the archangels and all the company of heaven. And they are here too. This room is so full of God's people. You see, that's the other side of the story. I brought that, this picture. I think many of you know that picture. This comes from my office. It is titled The First Day in Heaven. If you've never had an opportunity to see this print before, you see, this is the other side of the story. We gather together today as John on the island of Patmos, hearts heavy, confident in the promises of Jesus, but having witnessed them fully yet, trusting in those promises. That's Mom. You see, Mom is the other side of the story. We take our joy knowing that it's not just Mom is no longer hurting anymore. While there is some great comfort in that, this goes far beyond not hurting anymore. This is joy that exceeds all human understanding. And all of that came as a promise in those waters of holy baptism to Mom. A promise that she remembered each and every time she gathered in the Lord's house and around his word. Every time she knelt before his altar and received his body and blood, she was reminded that her sins are forgiven, and she was reminded that there is a day when it's going to be more than just an ending of pain and sorrow. That it is going to be total and absolute and eternal joy. So as you continue on as a family of faith, as you continue to gather in the Lord's house, and you continue to be reminded that the Lord has put that same mark upon each one of you, see both sides of the story. Know that here you are the church militant, that you are going to experience trials and suffering. You're certainly experiencing them today, not just as a family that has lost one of its precious loved ones, but as a family that, as of today, cannot be given the privilege of properly mourning or grieving that loss. But the other side of the story is this. There's joy and celebration. Joy and celebration for mom, and joy and celebration awaiting each and every one of you. And it's all in the precious name and in the power of Jesus' blood, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. We pray this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And may that peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus until life everlasting. Let us pray to the Lord our God and Father who raised Jesus from the dead. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and so pass with him through the gate of death and the grave to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant that all who have been nourished by the holy body and blood of your Son may be raised to immortality and incorruption and to be seated with him at your heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give to the family of Jacqueline and to all who mourn comfort in their grief, a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy, give courage and faith to the bereaved, that within the communion of your church, they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the assurance of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love who have departed in the faith. Lord, in your mercy, help us, we pray, in the midst of things that we cannot understand, to believe and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive our thanks for Jackie and for all the blessings you have bestowed on her in this earthly life. Bring us at last to our heavenly home, that with her we may see you face to face in the joys of paradise. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks that by his death he destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Taught by our Lord, trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says our Lord. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For
resurrection and the life, says our Lord. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
Thank you, Brother Jeff. As a member of our family, we welcome you. You used to be there today, but that's okay. First, I told my kids I'd use notes because they didn't want me to be speaking as long as I normally do to them. So I made a promise I intend to keep. First, on behalf of my brothers and our family, especially Jackie's brother Jerry, who was unable to be here today due to the travel restrictions going on in our country right now, we want to thank those watching from a distance online for your love you've shown to Jackie over the years, and even more recently while she was in hospice care. Your cards, we read every one of them. Your emails, we read all those to her as well. Your well wishes, but especially your prayers for her as God prepared to bring her home to him. It's actually, Pastor Jeff and I didn't prepare this at all, but it ties in quite well because my thoughts for today were really geared about perspective. And we've had a lot of influence having being children of a pastor's family, and perspective was one that I remember clearly growing up. My brothers can attest as well that my dad would say, if you're at a Christian's funeral, if it's a funeral for someone who has Jesus in their heart and has him Lord of their life, he used to say, never feel sorry for the guy in the box. And it's he'd say, never feel sorry for a guy in the box. For those of you watching also might know Bill, and he was not the most refined human on the planet. Thankfully, Mom fixed that through his sons, because we're quite refined. But that's just kind of how he said it. He said, never feel sorry for the guy in the box. He'd tell us there's nothing wrong with crying, there's nothing wrong with mourning or weeping, because that has its place, but he would also always take us to 1 Thessalonians 4:13. Do not grieve as others do who have no hope. So as believers, we actually grieve in a little bit of a different way. There is crying, there's mourning, and there's difficulty on this side of heaven, as Pastor talked about the two sides of the story. On this side of the story, it's difficult for us, but we also are called to make sure we're ready to share that hope that we have, that we're not to grieve in that way as well. Perspective, another way that has influenced kind of my perspective. There's a pastor, I think he's over in San Francisco, a guy that's online, I don't agree with his doctrine. His name is Francis Chan, and it's a lot of works, righteousness, and things like that, so I stopped watching him for a while. Someone sent me, there's a four-minute video of Francis Chan. It's called a rope illustration. Like, he has this rope that he's preaching from this rope. It's just a four-minute part, but if you look up Francis Chan on YouTube, has a great perspective of our faith life, the Christian's timeline of existence as well. Jackie's perspective, Mom's perspective, especially as she got a little older, was interesting. Her concept of time seemed a bit interesting to me. When I was able to get to Luther Manor and we'd take her to Pastor Miller's Bible study or to worship in the Faith Center, or even on Saturdays when we go to the movies with Rusty in the Linden Room, and I'd bring her in, and when she'd introduce me to people on a number of occasions, she'd say, "This is my son. He visits me every day." And I was always kind of taken aback because it was an interesting perspective of time. I do not visit her every day, not really even close to every day. I try to visit her 3 or 4 times a week, but somehow she thinks that I was visiting her every day. If anyone from Luther Manor is watching, maybe I should apologize for allowing my mom to lie to you. Made me feel good as a son that she thought I was there every day, but her perspective on time was quite interesting. Lastly, the most important, when we look for perspective, again, Pastor shared quite a bit from God's Word, but also I go back to 2 Peter 3, verse 8. With the Lord, one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. And I know, doctrinally, it's a metaphor. It's not supposed to be taken literally. It just means heaven's not dictated by our time here on this earth. But I have a math background, and anytime the Bible starts to spew out numbers, I do conversion rates in my head. And with that rate, if one day in heaven is like 1,000 years here on earth, so 1,000 years on earth divided by 24 hours in heaven, that rounds to 1 hour in heaven is about 42 years here on this earth. So if you think about it, if I live to be 126, please take me way before that, Lord, I'm sure you will, but if I live to be 126, that's only 3 hours in heaven. So that perspective of time helps me know that those loved ones that are there now, they don't actually miss us. It sounds kind of mean, but they don't have time to miss us. It's not going to seem that long to them. We're stuck on this timeline that they're not stuck on. So, for instance, for Dad got his Jesus hug, as we call it, and Pastor talked about great stories with him too, back in 2012. And ever since that day, Mom had been patiently waiting to see him again. It was my brothers and our families will attest, it was a rough 8 years. She really didn't want to be here. You know, she couldn't wait to get there. So it was a long 8 years for us. From Dad's perspective, in heaven, those 8 years rounds to about 11 minutes. So he's actually only been in heaven for 11 minutes. Many of you, again, if you're watching, and those in the room, know Bill Kohlmeyer. First things he'd do in heaven, there's three things that he would do for sure once he got in heaven. First, he'd accept his Jesus hug and just thank the Lord so much for paying that price for his salvation. Once he got done with that, he'd find a golf course for sure. After that, he'd look for the bakery that's closest to the golf course to get his chocolate donut. So once he's done with those three things, that 11 minutes it might still be going. He might still be searching for the bakery, and yet Mom is with him already. So while it was a struggle for her, it certainly wasn't something, he wasn't dictated by the same time frame. So hopefully, I know I take comfort in that idea that Mom's not going to miss me, and Dad doesn't necessarily miss me. That kind of helps with some of the mourning that we go through. In closing, Lord, please tell Jackie that we love her. Tell her we're so happy for her. Tell her she is a great mom. And tell her we'll see you in a couple hours. Thank you, Lord.
Let us pray. Lord God, our shepherd, you gather the lambs of your flock into the arms of your mercy, and you bring them home. Comfort us with a sure and certain hope of the resurrection to everlasting life, and that joyful reunion with those whom we love that have died in the faith. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
And let us go forth in that peace in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and always, always give you his peace. Amen. And let us close with our final hymn.